The people who are down the bottom are worshipping. The elders who are part way up are worshipping. Nadab and Aaron and Abihu who come a bit further up, they're worshipping. And Moses, when he ends up on the top of the mountain at the end of the chapter, he's worshipping. The whole thing is worship. The whole chapter is bathed in worship, and it reminds us something about our lives. That everything that we do, every part, every aspect of how we live should be worship. Worship isn't about singing songs, it's about honouring God with our lives.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called The Blood of the Old Covenant, Exodus chapter 24, verses 1 to 18, by Pastor David Wise.
Father God, it's been good to be together this morning to worship, to praise, to pray. It's been really good over connection time to meet up with one another, to chat together, to meet people for the first time, even to prophesy and pray over each other. Father, thank you. Father, it's good now as we come to look at your word, and we ask that you will help us. Father, we don't just want to gain more information this morning. We want you to speak into our lives, into our situations. We want to have an encounter with you as we encounter your word, and ask you to work in us, among us. In Jesus' name, amen. Apologies for the sound, we're working on it. It will settle down in a few moments. Well, because I've been on annual leave and I've also been finishing off at the other church that I've been looking after, we've had a break from Exodus, and it's possible that you've started meeting with us in the last few weeks since we last did Exodus. But on Sunday mornings when I'm here, most of the time, we've been looking at the book of Exodus, and the book of Exodus and the events in it, probably the most significant part of the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and it's foundational also to much of the New, and some of that we will see this morning. We started actually doing Exodus in November last year. And if you've missed any of it and you want to see where we've got to, if you go to our website, you will find all the teaching on Exodus is there. It's all in really good quality sound. You can see me as well. Got a bit of appreciation. And it's all there, and you can look at it 24 hours a day. So if you're up in the middle of the night, I was talking to someone the other day who is a night worker, so they're often awake in the middle of the night, and they've started listening to me. I didn't ask, does it help you go to sleep? But 3 o'clock in the morning, they're on our website looking at the teaching. So it's there, and encourage you to do that. And today, where we come to is a very significant moment in this history that we have been walking through together. And we come to this chapter, chapter 24. It's a moment when the people of Israel, who have been delivered from slavery, do you remember they were back in Egypt? They were on the receiving end of a policy of genocide. And God rescued them, a whole series of plagues and demonstrations of God's power. God rescued them from Egypt. And we looked at part of that, the Passover. Do you remember that night when the firstborn of every Egyptian family died, and the blood on the doorposts, and the deliverance from Egypt of the people of Israel? And then we followed them out into the wilderness, and we saw them cross the Red Sea. Do you remember that? They walked through that walls of water either side. God brought them through. We've seen them now come to Mount Sinai, where they've been for the last a few chapters, and God's been speaking to them. We'll come back to that in a moment. And now we're at this point where, in the reading we're going to look at today, they make a renewed covenant with God. It's known as the theologians call it the Sinaitic covenant. It's the covenant that was made on the top of Mount Sinai. And we're going to be looking at that today. Now, this passage we're going to look at today, just to warn you in advance, this is it's a bit complex, and it is seriously deep in terms of the theology that is here. And so you're going to have to work with me today. If you're a visitor here or you've started coming since I last did any teaching, my style's very interactive, so I ask questions, we're going to discuss together. But in some of the things today, you're going to need to, if your brain is still asleep and the coffee you've just had's not hit it yet, you might just want to shake your head, because you're going to need to use some of that grey matter this morning as we work through this passage. But before we start that, last time we came to the end of three chapters where we looked at a series of... three chapters of... Exodus, yeah, very good, Ismat. What was in the three chapters of Exodus, Ismat?
Law, justice.
It was laws, three chapters. We started off with the 10 words or the 10 commandments, then a whole series of laws after that. Yeah, do you remember that? Ring any bells? Yeah? And remember, when we looked at a lot of those, when we first looked at them, you think, what has this got to do with living in West London in 2008? You know, oxen and cows and donkeys and all this sort of stuff. What's it got to do with us? But as we looked at those laws, do you remember, we saw that there were a series of principles that we learned from that, because God is still the same, amen? God hasn't changed. Human beings, we might think ourselves a bit more sophisticated, we might drive cars today, we might be involved in a global credit crunch, but the character of human beings is basically the same today as it was then, amen? And so the principles about how God deals with people then apply? Absolutely. So we saw some principles as we went through. So, revision time. You look so pleased. Revision time. Let's just go back over some of these principles. Can you remember what some of the main principles that we learnt from these three chapters about God and about us and about how we should live? What were some of the things that came out of those three chapters?
Yeah. No special treatments, nor for rich, neither for rich nor for poor.
Justice, yeah, no special treatment. You don't get special treatment because you're rich. You don't get special treatment because you're poor. Everyone is treated equally. So God's heart for justice, yes, very good. What else? Linda.
About setting aside time to rest and relax and give glory to God.
Yeah, we saw that was a creation, something that God has built into the way that you are made. You are made with a need to rest one day in seven. And we saw that is a requirement, because that's how God's made us. So we saw that as a principle. And also particularly for the poor. And we commented how in our society, often it is those who are at the bottom end of society economically that aren't given opportunity to rest, and how we need to be people who are vigorous in the whole thing of rest. Thank you. What else? Bosse?
Social responsibility.
Social responsibility. It's not just about me, myself, I, but it is about our role with others in society and in the world. God gives us responsibility for that. And if the world had listened more to that, we wouldn't have quite so much mess that we're in at the moment, would we? What else? Mary?
The importance of the seventh year and the seventh day. I think Linda said it, but
yep.
The rest.
The rest, seventh year, seventh day. Yes, what else? What other principles? Some other big ones we've not picked up yet. Can see the cogs turning. Yes, Denisa.
Within a spot, not tolerate people worshipping other gods.
Okay, so we're to worship God alone. He's a jealous God. He does not put up with us playing fast and loose with him. Yeah, very good. Yes, what else? There's some other big things. One really, really big thing that we've not said yet.
I don't know if it's big mercy, the merciful God.
Yeah, it's a God of mercy. Yeah. The really big thing for me that we haven't mentioned yet, yeah?
That God is concerned for every detail of our lives.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. That's one of the things. God is concerned for every area of life. One of the things we noticed about the laws, it's not just about what you do, you know, on the Sabbath, but actually every single area of life God cares about, and God wants the best for in that. Every single area of life, yes. There's a group of people that God is passionate about. It's the voiceless and the poor. God is passionate about the poor, caring for those who are weak and vulnerable, those without voice in society. God cares about those, and because of that, so should we, his people. We should be reflecting God's values and God's standards in the way that we treat other people. Okay, there's a couple of other things that I saw when I went through. Yeah, Leslie.
False witness against your neighbour.
Okay, you've got to tell the truth. Yeah, you mustn't bear false witness about your neighbour. Timmy, were you waving at me, scratching, or you were just scratching? Dangerous thing. Don't go to an auction, Timmy. It's very dangerous.
The only place for sexual intercourse is within marriage.
Yep, that's one. The only place for sexual intercourse is within marriage. We're doing pretty well. There's only one other thing that I've got on my list we've not picked up so far. Yes?
No matter your work schedule, create a Sabbath for God.
No, yes, the whole Sabbath, when we touched on that earlier on, there's another area.
A life for a life?
Yeah, that's in the whole thing of justice. Yeah, we touched on that, yeah.
It's about aliens, but I can't remember what it was.
Aliens. That's right. This is old God's passion for aliens, and we talked about the fact that they weren't actually from Mars. Aliens was the technical term for a resident foreigner who lived in the land. They were known as aliens. They were people who were resident in Israel, and God has a passion for them. And there are a whole lot of laws about their rights. Now, the other thing we've not talked about is occult activity. Remember, we touched on that, how serious it is being involved in the occult. And that if you get involved in that, it is very damaging to you and very dangerous indeed. And so there are laws about that. That's pretty good. I think you should give yourself a round of applause. Well done. So let's come to this chapter today, chapter 24, which we're going to work through this morning. And we'll begin at verse 1 and we'll finish at the end of the chapter. So slightly less verses today than we normally work through, but that's because, well, you'll see as we go through. Then he said to Moses, this is God speaking, "Come up to the Lord, you and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. You are to worship at a distance, but Moses alone is to approach the Lord. The others must not come near, and the people may not come up with him." This is now happening at Mount Sinai, and the events here, this chapter is a transition chapter. The previous three chapters have been the law that we've talked about. From chapter 25 all the way through to chapter 32 takes place when Moses is on the top of the mountain. So this is the transition when Moses is moving from here to the top of the mountain. It's a transition chapter. One of the things I want you to notice as we go through this chapter, you see it here in verse 1, right at the beginning. And it's a theme throughout this chapter. You are to worship at a distance. So this whole chapter is bathed in worship. The people who are down the bottom are worshiping. The elders who are part way up are worshiping. Nadab and Aaron and Abihu who come a bit further up, they're worshiping. And Moses, when he ends up on the top of the mountain at the end of the chapter, he's worshiping. The whole thing is worship. The whole chapter is bathed in worship, and it reminds us something about our lives. That everything that we do, every part, every aspect of how we live should be worship. Worship isn't about singing songs, it's about honouring God with our lives. I don't know whether you remember some months ago now when I was speaking on a different part of, it was when I was looking at 1 Peter a while ago. I suggested that people, for a week, put a reminder in their mobile phones. So their phone would go off every day when they were at work with the question, "Are you worshipping?" Because you ought to be worshipping just as much tomorrow morning at 10:30, tomorrow afternoon at 2:30, as you are here this morning. The whole of life should be bathed in worship because we're giving ourselves to God all the time. Amen? Every situation is about honouring God with what we do. And so this whole chapter is bathed in worship as our lives ought to be. So, let's come on. Verse 3. When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." Moses then wrote down everything the Lord had said, just so they didn't forget. He got up early next morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. And then he sent young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and put it in bowls, and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it to the people. They responded, "We will do everything the Lord has said. We will obey." Moses then took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, "This is the Lord of the covenant. Sorry, this is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went up. We'll pick that up in a moment. So they are there. Moses writes everything down, and then there's a reference there to the book of the covenant. And that's almost certainly the things that he'd just written down, which is most likely what we have looked at in the last three chapters, beginning with the Ten Commandments and those other rules and laws which follow afterwards, the book of the covenant. Moses wrote it all down, and then he read it to the people. So they'd heard it once, he wrote it down, he read it again. And the people committed themselves to keeping God's word. Now, there's something about this that we need to understand. You see, as Christians, when we look back at Old Testament laws, we sometimes have the idea that it was by keeping these laws that people got themselves right with God. But somehow they had to tick all the boxes. They had to do all the right things. And then when they got all the boxes ticked, done all the right things, they were right with God. And that is a real misunderstanding of the purpose of the law in the Old Testament and the purpose of God wanting us to live our lives in a particular way for now. You need to understand that the Book of the Covenant and all the other Old Testament laws are not about becoming God's people. They are an expression of relationship. It's not about ticking the boxes. You know, you apply for a grant these days for somebody, and they send you this form. You've got to be able to tick that you've got this, and you've got that, and you've got the other, and all of that. All about ticking boxes. This is not ticking boxes. This is about relationship with God. This was not about how to win God's favor. But it's about that in the light of the fact that these are God's people, how should they live? So it's not about earning God's favor. It's about the fact we are God's people. In the light of the fact that we are God's people, how should we now live? See, that's very different to keeping lots of laws so that God likes you, because you can't do that. Are you with me? Right, let's jump forward a few thousand years. If that was then, how does that work for us now? Because as I read the New Testament, it's not a law book like the Old Testament, but there are a lot of things there that God says that we should do, and a lot of things that God says we shouldn't do. Yeah? You with me? You nodding? Yeah, nodding's good. Nodding off's not good, but nodding is good. Okay. So what does this mean then when we come to that? Do you see where we're going? This was how it was under the old covenant. How does it work for us then under the new covenant? What's the same and what is different? Told you, you're going to have to use your brains this morning. Yeah.
We can't get into a relationship with God by what we manage to do or not do, but when we're in a relationship with God, it must affect our behaviour afterwards.
Okay, so that bit is the same. We can't earn God's favour by doing the things that in his word he says we should do. But if we are his people, we should be living our lives the way that he says we should live them, as an expression of our response to God, expression of our relationship. So that's the same, old and new. But what's different? No, that's absolutely right. There's two questions. What's the same and what's different? That's what's the same. There is something that is different. It's not in the text that we've read this morning, so you can look hard at it and you won't see it, but there is something profoundly different.
Today we have direct access to God through Jesus Christ. They had to have the blood of the animals and the priests as a barrier between them.
Yeah, so we have direct access to God now. We don't have to go through the priest. What else? What does that mean? Yeah? Something else.
We have the help of the Holy Spirit.
Absolutely. We have the help of the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament times, the Holy Spirit was not poured out except on exceptional circumstances on people, handful of them. You could probably count them on your fingers and toes in the whole of the Old Testament. But now we have God in our hearts. In the Old Testament, the law was written on tablets of stone. In the New Testament, the law is written where? Where does the Bible say it's written now? It's written on our heart. And we have the Holy Spirit in our lives. It's just as important that we live our lives the way that God wants us to, because that is for the best for us. But now it's on the inside, and we have God living in our lives through his Holy Spirit helping us. So there are some things that are different, and there are some things that are the same. Okay? The ceremony that they had here needs a little bit of explanation. Try and imagine in your mind for a moment. They got 12 big stones. I don't know quite how big they were, but they got 12 big stones, and they put them in a circle. And in the middle of that circle, they built an altar. Now, those 12 big stones, those 12 pillars, represent the people of God in their 12 tribes. And they're in a circle. But at the center is God. The altar represents the place where God's feet touches earth. They didn't see God as a stone, it was a symbolic thing. And it's as though somebody, to use a modern phrase, somebody else I read, I didn't make this up, this is a pinch from somebody else, described this as setting the relationship in concrete, putting it together, visualizing it together. Now, the burnt offering, when a burnt offering was made, everything was burnt. So the whole of the animal that was offered as a burnt offering was burnt, every bit. And that symbolizes the fact that everything in life is given over to God. Jumping forward to us, we say that if Jesus is not Lord of all, he is not Lord at all. Everything we have as Christians, everything, every part, every aspect of life is given over to God. Yes? Amen? You don't sound terribly sure. We'll ask you that question again. For us in the New Testament times, for Jesus to be our Lord, it means that every single aspect and part of life, without any exception whatsoever, is given over to God. Amen? And we don't do burnt offerings today, but that's what this symbolized, everything being given over to God. Then there is this other sacrifice, which is one you may not be familiar with. It's what's known as a fellowship offering. It's not a sin offering, it's a fellowship offering. And in fact, it's something that we still do in church quite often, for reasons that we'll see in a few minutes' time. The fellowship offering is something we have brought over into church. To give you a clue, we're going to do it next week. There would have been a huge amount of blood here. I mean, bulls have got a lot of blood in them. You've got all this blood from the burnt offerings, all this blood from the fellowship offerings, bowls, big bowls and bowls of blood. So what is all this blood about? Well, in the Old Testament, it was believed that blood contained the life. Okay. They understood that in the Old Testament, blood contained the life. That is why Jehovah's Witnesses will not have blood transfusions. It's taken from an Old Testament belief that the life is in the blood. So if you take someone's blood, I'm not saying this is correct, I'm a blood donor, I give blood and, you know, so on. But their understanding is that, you know, Ismat gives some of his blood and I'm very ill, so that blood is given to me. Some of Ismat's life comes into me, and that is wrong for Jehovah's Witnesses. That's where they're coming from with that. They're understanding a truth correctly, Old Testament truth, but they're making, I believe, a wrong application of that. So the blood contains the life. And the life in the Old Testament always belongs to, all life belongs to God. We saw that principle before when we were looking at murder and capital punishment. Do you remember? All life belongs to God. Okay, so we've got these bowls, we've got all these bowls of blood. Moses takes half the blood and he pours it on the altar. Then later on, he takes the other half of the blood and he sprinkles it over all the people. I see a few grimaces there in people's faces. Found some bull's blood this morning, you know. So what is that about? Well, what that is about is this. It symbolizes the close relationship or fellowship between God and his people. God is, listen to this, God is one blood with his people. In some cultures, we don't do it, English people don't do it in West London. I know in other cultures, they have this idea of blood brothers. Yeah, where two people will each cut themselves and they will mix their blood. Yeah, you're familiar with that idea? And it's about a commitment of two people together, in fellowship together, in relationship together. And that is the concept that is here. This idea of this blood in this way. It also makes it clear that this relationship between God and his people, to quote one of the people I've been reading this week, is a guy called Freedom, who's a brilliant writer on Exodus. He talks about the way that this blood makes clear that this is a matter of life or death. Okay, this is not a peripheral thing. This is about life or death. This is about sharing in God's life. But the sharing in God's life for the people comes about at the expense of another life. The sharing of God's life for human beings comes about because of the shedding of blood of another innocent life. We're going to come to the New Testament part of that a little bit later on. But you see the principle that is there in the Old Testament. And the other thing that goes on here, Freedom again, writing about this passage. I was going to quote him because he sums this up brilliantly. He talks about the themes here all the way through this chapter, which we'll see a bit more later on. We've begun to see it already. The themes of communion, the themes of real divine presence, and the sharing of life through concrete reality. Now, we're going to pick that up again in 10 minutes' time or so. We'll come back to that. And we'll pick up this whole thing of blood again in a moment. You still with me? Turn to somebody and say, I don't want to be covered in bull's blood this morning. But I'm glad I'm covered by the blood of Jesus. Amen. All right, we then come to this concept of covenant that is here. They make a covenant together. Covenant, the word covenant and testament are the same word. So we have the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, and we have the New Covenant, the New Testament. Okay, Testament, Covenant, the words are interchangeable. So here, they make a covenant with God. Now, they were already God's people. Okay, when Abraham was called, remember, Abraham was in Ur of the Chaldees, and God said to him, leave, you and your people. Didn't tell them where they were going, but they left. This was, and then there was this covenant, this relationship formalized between God and Abraham and his descendants. Remember that back in Genesis? Some of you are familiar with it. That's the foundational covenant for the people in the Old Testament, and it applies still to us as well in ways that I'm not going to explore this morning, but we also are part of that Abrahamic covenant when we come into relationship with Jesus. But they're already in covenant, so this is, if you like, an additional covenant that they're taking on here. So what was taking place here was a clearer spelling out of what was involved in the relationship. As I've said, it's not about people's status, are they God's people or not, but it's about how they live their lives. Now notice something about what goes on here, and Christians take notice of this. There's no negotiation. God says, these are the terms. Okay, no negotiation. Are you hearing me? No negotiation. I'm forever talking to Christians. I say forever, it just seems like forever. And, you know, they'll be sitting with me and I'll say, but the Bible says, let's take an obvious example, the Bible says no sex outside of marriage. And the couple will sit there with me and say, but Pastor, you know, we love one another so much. God is at the center of our relationship. And I say, but God says what you're doing is wrong because you're not married. And they say, but we know God is at the center of our relationship. There's no negotiation with God. Do you hear me? And there are reasons why God says, I'm not going to go back to that particular illustration, but God wants the best for us. I'm going to pick on Ismat again because he was naughty earlier on. So your comment about Exodus, you know, that was it. Now, God wants the very best for Ismat, as he does for anyone. I can pick on any one of you, but Ismat's part of my leadership, so broad leadership here, so I can pick on him. God wants the very best for Ismat. Amen? Amen? So God says to Ismat, this is how you're to live your life, Ismat. There are these things that you mustn't do. There are these things that you should do. And Ismat looks at those things, and some of those things he doesn't understand, perhaps, why God is saying, Ismat, you can't do that. But you see, God wants the best for Ismat. God's made Ismat. God knows everything about Ismat. Every single aspect and facet of his life, God knows and understands. And God wants the best for him. And even when Ismat doesn't understand, I know Ismat well, Ismat still does what God tells him to do. Because God wants the best for him. And sometimes we look at these rules and regulations that some people dismiss that are there about our morality, the way that we live our lives and all the rest of it. And they say, this is, you know, we've grown up beyond that now. That doesn't apply to us today. Human beings are still the same. God is still the same. God still wants the best for you, which is why God says this is how you should live your life. And there is no negotiation. The choice is you accept it or you reject it. And the people required faith. As Ismat, as he walks with God, he has to trust that God knows what he's doing. He has to exercise faith in God. And so for us, for you, for me, the same principles apply there as now. Everything belongs to God. The way we live our lives matters. Every aspect, every part. God wants the very, very best for us, which is why there is no negotiation. It's not because God doesn't care, it's because he does. It's not because he doesn't care, it's because he does. Let's look at the next couple of verses, and then we'll come back to this. I've got another question for you. Verse 9. Moses and Aaron Nadab and Abihu and the 70 elders of Israel went up and saw the God of Israel. Under his feet there was something like a pavement made of sapphire, clear as the sky itself. But God did not raise his hand against these leaders of the Israelites. They saw God and they ate and drank. They ate and drank with God. This is a fellowship meal with God. If you want to do a cultural transfer, instead of sapphire pavement, read red carpet. It's probably our cultural equivalent to a sapphire pavement is red carpet. Red carpet signifying honor and worthiness. And God is awesomely present, manifestly present. One more quote from Friedheim. It's the last quote from Friedheim this morning. God is committed to a real presence with his people in all of their journeyings, a deeply personal level of involvement. I want you to think about yourself. We've been looking at these people here. We don't go up mountains and have clouds and lightning and sapphire pavements and all of that, red carpets with God standing on it. What do we learn from this passage about ourselves and our relationship with God before we move on to the next section? We're going to talk about the whole thing of communion later on, so I don't want us to get into that now. I want to talk about Jesus shed blood and communion later on this morning. We'll come back to that. But what else do we learn out of this about the way that we walk with God and the way that God is with us? What are the principles that apply to us from this? It's a very deep passage. Joan.
In all of this, it shouts out to me that we matter to God. That as individuals and as group, we matter to God.
Yeah.
Which is why all of this.
We matter to God. It's why all of this. We matter to God. It's an awesome thing. I mean, we read here about God sitting down with his people, sharing table fellowship, sharing a meal with them. Part of his creation. And all that God did, the plagues, supernatural food, they're still being fed supernaturally. There still is the fast food delivery every day of meat and manna coming every day, provided for them at this point in time. They matter. We matter. God cares about human beings. Thank you. What else?
Yes, we need to be hearing from God daily.
Yeah.
Listen to his voice and keep his commandment. Whatever he says.
Yeah. We need to be listening to God's voice every day and hearing his commandments. One of the very powerful things that comes out of this for me is this idea of God journeying with us. Now we see, remember that as they moved across the wilderness, they had the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud, cloud by day, fire by night. God was journeying with them. Here they stop. God comes and eats with them. There are New Testament parallels of that. For us today, we have God with us, don't we? We have God the Holy Spirit. We don't need a pillar of fire and cloud because we have God the Holy Spirit journeying with us. And journeying with us throughout the whole of life. For many of you, journeying with you as you've gone from one part of the world to another part of the world. From one culture to another culture. Find yourselves here in West London at this point in time. But as you've journeyed, God has travelled with you all the time. God is as much here as he was there. And through every stage of life, as you get older, God journeys with you. Mary talked about earlier on, moving away in the near future, 40 years having been in Greenford. And she knows that God's going to go with her in her journey, albeit only just down the road, because if you talk to Mary about the last 40 years and the journey of the last 40 years, Mary would tell you, as she hinted at in the testimony this morning, that every stage of that, and some of those stages have been very, very difficult stages, every one of those stages, God has been with her. God has journeyed with her. Is that right, Mary? Journeyed with her all the time.
I didn't always know it, but it was true.
Yeah. Yes, you didn't always know God was there, but he was when you look back and you see. Journeying with us all the time. Journeying with us all the time. And that's true for you today. Whatever your situation, whatever your place, whatever your context, God is journeying with you. And for some of you, you're in a really tough place at the moment. It's a hard place you're in. You may not feel God with you, but God is journeying with you. God is as much with you when you are aware of him as when you're not aware of him. He journeys with you all the time, all the time, every context, every situation. We have a God that goes with us. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's go on to these next few verses, verses 12 down to 18. Then the Lord said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commands I've written on for their instruction. Then Moses set out with Joshua, his assistant, and Moses went up on the mountain of God. He said to the elders, wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them. When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on the mountain, covered the mountain for 6 days. And on the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went up on the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. This cloud and this fire proclaimed God's presence. It was really a visual aid to help the people. So they knew that when Moses came down and he brought some new revelation from God, they knew it had come from God. The whole thing about cloud and fire, of course, is that it reveals God, but it conceals him. It shows he's there, but it also conceals him, because the people could not see him. 40 days, the number 40, most of you will be aware, is a symbolic number. You find it throughout the Old Testament, symbolic number that stands for a long period of time. And so Moses is there, and he's going to be there for the next few chapters. We're going to pick up the story next week. Now, I want to make some links and for us to do some work here on how this relates to the new covenant. And I'd like you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 26. If you've got one of our church Bibles, you'll find it on page 996. Matthew chapter 26. While they were eating, verse 26, Jesus took bread and gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. Now listen to these words closely, and you'll see the Old Testament parallel. This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And I tell you the truth, I will not drink of the fruit of this vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. There's some obvious parallels there. Table fellowship with God. When we celebrate communion together, God is present with us. Maybe we should put out a red carpet whenever we have communion. What do you think? Because God is present with us. And this phrase here, I'm going to not drink wine again until we have a meal together in my Father's kingdom. We're going to sit down. We're going to eat together. That's when we're going to eat together next, Jesus said to his disciples. So having looked at that passage in Exodus 24, looking at this here, how does understanding, now this is probably the hardest question for the morning, and it's the last question, so your brains can rest a bit after this. When we look at that Old Testament background that we've worked through leading up to chapter 24, not just chapter 24 of Exodus, but all the stuff that has led up to that, the plagues, the Passover, the Red Sea, the wilderness, Sinai, covenant, bulls and blood, all of that together, how does that help us in our understanding? How does it deepen our understanding of the New Testament? Because every one of those things is paralleled in our experience if we're Christians. Being set free from the power of sin. The plagues, being set free from Egypt, which stands for sin. And that happening because of the Passover, the lamb that was slain, his blood saved the people. And when they went out, they were baptized as they passed through the sea. And they followed God in the wilderness and came to this point of table fellowship with God and making commitment to God, covenant. To see how all of that is our experience, it was their experience. God hasn't changed. People haven't changed. Jesus has come. It's now on a different basis. But the same pattern is there, all those elements. So how does looking at that, as we've been doing so closely, how does it help us to understand, deepen our understanding of the New Testament and our own experience? What would you like to share with us about that? Turn it over in your mind. Is Matt?
To share the life of God, that happens only through the innocent life of Jesus. He was the sacrifice.
Okay. So there is that. These people in the Old Testament, in fact, only were able to have forgiveness for sins because that shedding of that blood in the Old Testament was a foreshadowing, was an anticipation of Jesus' death. His death rolled back through time, not just forward in time, but rolled back through time. And there is that death of the innocent that enables the guilty to be forgiven. Very good. What else? Joan?
There's a sense in which in the Old Testament, if the people expressed it, they would say, God is doing this for us. There's an individual side of it in the New Testament. Yeah. But isn't there in the Old Testament?
Yes, in the Old Testament, there is this relationship between God and people on block. Whereas in the New Testament, there is this individual relationship. Yes, we are God's people, but we come into it in a different way than the Old Testament people did. It is for me rather than just for us. Yes, that's a very, very important point. Anything else? Yes, Matt?
At the beginning of Exodus 24, I mean, the word was saying about worship at distance. and when God was sharing them with the meal.
Yep.
Now he, in the flesh, he shared the meal with the disciples.
Yes. When Jesus died on the cross, that piece of fabric that separated the Holy of Holies from the holy place was torn in two from top to bottom. There was all the time in worship in the Old Testament, always physical distance between people and God because they were an unholy people. And so in the New Testament, Jesus sits and eats with his disciples face to face. In our relationship now, we come directly to God. When we worship God, we have a sense of God's presence now. We go into God's presence. We take it for granted that we can just go into God's presence. Because of the death of Jesus and that being torn from top to bottom. In the Old Testament, they couldn't do that. Once a year, one person went for a short period of time into the Holies of Holies. Once a year, one person. And they only ever did it once. The high priest for the year. Now, all of us, all the time, can go into God's presence. It's an awesome thing. We take it so much for granted. It's an awesome thing. Got time for one or two other comments just before we finish. There are one or two others. You might want to later on, I'm not going to read it now, I didn't plan to read it, but later on you might want to have a look at Hebrews chapter 9, and maybe later on today or tomorrow. Have a look at Hebrews chapter 9, particularly verses 15 down to verse 22. And look at the teaching there that just takes this stuff from the Old Testament to Jesus and to now. And think about that in the light of the things we've been looking at this morning. Okay, let's pull together the main things we've learned this morning in these last few minutes that we have in this time now. What are the key things that we take away from this morning into this week? It's not enough, as I say, on a regular basis for us to sit here and understand the Bible a bit more on a Sunday morning. It has to affect how we are during the week, how our life is. So what are the key things that we take away from this passage this morning, that we take into this week with us, that are going to be as relevant for us at 11:35 tomorrow morning, 12:30 tomorrow afternoon, as they are here, wherever you're going to be tomorrow? What are the key things we take away? I've got three I'm going to put on the screen in a moment, but yeah.
Worshipping God all the time.
Worship God all the time. Very good. Yes.
God is always journeying with us, whether we are aware or not.
God is always journeying with us. Yes.
God's word are not to be negotiated.
Yeah, God's word is not up for negotiation. We just take it and do it. Yes. Birch.
As his promises are sure.
His promises are sure. All the time. Yes. Leslie.
That's all right.
Okay, that's fine. You were just waving at me, yeah?
I was.
Yeah, that's very nice. Last couple, Lorraine.
We have a story to tell to the nations that Jesus has died for us, and so we can all have new life.
Yeah, we've got a story to tell to the nations. Very good. Yes, Modipay.
We're obeying his words.
We need to be obeying his words. Sorry, two more. I did say that was the last two, but Hannah?
God wants us to fellowship with him always.
God wants us to fellowship with him always. Steve?
We be obedient to God, and we have the gift of the Holy Spirit to give us the ability to do that.
Yeah, we should be obedient to God. We've got the gift of the Holy Spirit to help us do that. The three things that seem the key things to me as I look at this, as you said, all of life should be grounded in worship. Every part of our life should be lived God's way. Everything that we do, all the time. And God is present with us on our journey. Let's stand together. I'm going to pray for you as we finish this. We will pick this up again next week. If you want to read ahead, you can read chapter 25. We'll be looking at that next Sunday morning. Father God, as we have looked back this morning, thousands of years, to your people there on Mount Sinai, we thank you that these things were written for us. Father, we thank you for ourselves today that you sent your Son into the world to die on the cross so that we can know your life, His blood shed, His blood poured out, that we can share fellowship with You. I thank You, Father, You're not a God just out there in the bright blue beyond. You are a God that has table fellowship with us. You're a God that journeys with us. You're a God that's in our lives all the time, every place, every situation that we face. You are there. You are with us. Father God, thank You. I ask, Father God, for all of us here today that You will help us this week at work, at college, at home, with our neighbours, with our friends, wherever we are, whatever context, whatever situation that we're in. Help us to be living our lives the way that You want us to live our lives. That we can be the very best that You have created us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Please sit down. We don't have a meeting this evening. You don't need to rush away. Do stand and talk. If there's anything that's come out of this morning, you'd like to talk with somebody or pray with somebody, please grab any of the broader leaders and they'll be very happy to sit with you, talk with you and pray with you. God bless you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.